You won't get this from any other guy. And if you ask me how I'm feeling, try to make you understand, never gonna give you up, never gonna let you down, never gonna run around and desert you, never gonna make you cry, never gonna say goodbye, never gonna tell a lie and desert you.
We often socialise together in groups and whatever. Had very good relationship, and it was only when he joined Scientology that this all happened.
Do you think it was something to do with the death of your mother? He went back.
Yes. I said my mum died very suddenly and unexpectedly in 1988. And Tony had been working in the States at the time, over in California, with a company called Amdahl. So he went back to the States very quickly after the funeral. And within weeks, seemingly, he was recruited by this organisation.
And have you any idea how the background, or did you ever get to the bottom of that in any way?
The way, yes, because some of the people that he was sharing an apartment with in California were friends from Ireland. So once we discovered that this was an organisation, once we started getting concerned about it, we contacted those friends who also were concerned, and they basically said, and a leaflet came in the door advertising Dianetics as a self-help group. And that's literally how he got into it. But they just happened to catch him, I think, at a very vulnerable time when he was away from family, at a time when he was suffering with a huge grief. He had been very, very close to my mother. And I think he found it, you know, when he was home for the funeral, he found it very difficult to talk to people. And I think when he went back, he met this group who obviously showed him sympathy. And that drew him in. And it took us, like this was back, as I said, 88. It took us a couple of years before we realised that the organisation he was involved in was something that we should have been concerned about. It was initially, it was like, you know, he's in America and there's so many of these self-help groups and whatever. We weren't concerned about it. But it was about 2 years later, a couple of his friends actually came to us and said, you know this organisation he's in? And then there was a Time magazine article. What year was that, Dennis?
91.
The 80s, right? Late 80s.
And I think that was when we really kind of suddenly got this, you know, God, is this what he's actually involved in? He'd been talking about Dianetics, not Scientology. So we didn't realise what either of the two of them were. So it was only, I think, when we saw this Time magazine article and we started to investigate it that we actually said, this is something that, you know, this is could potentially be serious and dangerous. Then he started talking about giving up his job and going to work for them full time.
But used to come over to his
dad? Oh, yes, he did, Joe. He had moved home. He had moved back to Ireland. He was only in the States for 6 months on this work placement for his company. So he was back working in Ireland. And he used to come in to do his courses here in this headquarters here in Abbey Street. At that stage, they had a full shop front and they had basement. They had shop downstairs. They had a bigger looking organisation than they seem to have today.
And was Gerard Ryan there at that time?
Gerard Ryan was there at that time as well, yeah. Yeah, he's been there all the time as well.
His brother was in it as well.
So when you were all back, he was back living in Dublin, you were living in Dublin, you were seeing him a lot.
We'd see him in and out. It was something he started talking about. He had changed personality-wise, yes. He had become more distant and everything was very talked about in a much more objective way. Emotionally, he seemed to be distancing himself from us very early on.
Could you think of any particular day or an example or chat you had, or you kind of went, something's going on here?
My nephew at the time was about two. I remember we just come back years ago and he was sitting at the kitchen table and he reached out his hand to touch the teapot. And he actually touched the teapot and nearly burned himself. And I said to him, why didn't you stop him? He'll never do that again. He's learned from his mistake. So it was like really odd kind of little things that he started talking about and saying and doing that we really just didn't understand. Well, my belief now is that he's under complete mind control. Why else would he have distanced himself from his whole family? We've had no disagreement with him about anything except our concerns about him being in Scientology. And once we started questioning and asking what he was doing, he started pulling back and didn't want to talk to us. And we firmly believe then that he was told by the Scientology organisation to disconnect from us because we started publicly questioning what he was doing and we started...
Was that after the Late Late Show?
That was after the Late Late Show in particular, yes. Because...
And do you ever regret doing that?
No,
do you think?
No. Very happy we did that. approximately a year later, was giving a lift home to a woman that I was doing a college course at the time, and I had offered a lift home to somebody. And I don't know how the conversation came up about Scientology, but it did. And she says to me, "Was that your brother on the Late Late Show?" She said her son had done a personality test in Scientology 2 weeks before that Late Show program had been broadcast. And she saw the Late Late Show program and talked to her son, and he never went back in again. And she firmly believes that he would have continued to go but for that Late Late Show program. So that one incident alone to me was, if we save one person from getting involved in Scientology and suffering the grief that our family has got to suffer, then it's actually worth it.
And how do you see now this Christmas again? You know, another Christmas.
Oh, it's this is now, as I said, been for so long now. And it is sad and it is hard, but I do think we're doing the right thing to stand up and to state constantly, this organisation has had a huge impact on my family. I have lost a relationship with a brother. My children have an uncle that isn't in their lives and should be. Tony was a very affectionate, caring person who I think would have loved, even if he hasn't a family or children of his own, would have been a very loving uncle, but for this organisation.
So how do you understand Gerard Ryan then?
I think Gerard Ryan, I feel sorry for Gerard Ryan. I think he is under complete mind control. He is a huge victim of this organisation. And I would imagine he owes millions at this stage with all the kind of activities that have been going on. So he probably owes millions to head office, wherever it is at this stage.
But he runs the place, doesn't he?
He runs the place. But have you ever seen anybody in there? Like, any time I've ever walked past here, I walked past here on Thursday, I was going somewhere. There's no lights on there during the week. There's nobody in there. I'd love to know all their claims about the number of people they have as Scientologists in Ireland. I haven't met any of them except Gerard Ryan in recent years. I haven't seen any of them. There's nobody else standing or speaking for Scientology in Ireland except Gerard Ryan. If all these people are in Scientology that he claims they are, where are they? I just don't know where they are. I don't believe they're around.
Well, maybe the kind of message here is working. I mean, maybe it's quite strong in Ireland, you know, that it's not.
And then we said, if that's what we can do, is save other families. And obviously, we want to save other families, but I certainly would hope that one day Tony will come home. And as a family group, we will all do everything we can to help him reintegrate back in if he comes back. I said, we will always have that hope.
Anything to get their hands on your money. It's a business posing as a religion.